Tantor Audio presents The Mediterranean Prescription by Angelo Acquista, M.D., with Laurie and Vandermolen. Narrated by Paul Costanzo. Publisher's Note. Figures, meal plans, and recipes from this audiobook appear in a printable PDF, which has been included on the first audio and MP3 CD. If you downloaded this audiobook in a digital format, please visit our website at www.tantor.com and type Mediterranean Prescription into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page, then click on PDF Extra 1. When prompted, enter the access code WEIGHTLOSS to access the bonus material. 1. The Mediterranean Prescription. When I was a young college student in New York, my father introduced me to a wise older doctor named Dr. Peter Seta. He was a Sicilian internist who practiced in downtown Manhattan and over time became somewhat of a mentor to me. He used to tell me that being a doctor was the noblest profession, and it was he who inspired me to go to medical school. I kept up my relationship with him throughout medical school and would often accompany him to see patients. He would tell me, "The best thing I can do for my patients is to get them to stop smoking and to help them lose weight." This was in the 1970s, when people didn't really pay attention to these issues. He personally saw the connection between being overweight and poor health among his patients, and took it upon himself to help those at risk. As a result, he developed a diet that he would describe briefly to his overweight patients, so easy to follow that he didn't even have to write it down, that he saw work over and over. He handed this down to me, a newly graduated doctor, and I never forgot it, in part because I had so much respect for this man, but mostly because, as I eventually found again and again with my own patients, it worked. Years ago, as I was starting out as a physician, I tried to help patients lose weight in a more traditional way. I used to tell them how to eat healthily, would give them papers on nutrition, and would refer them to nutritionists, but they weren't losing weight. In my frustration, I tried telling them about Dr. Seta's diet. I said, "Why don't you try this very simple diet?" They would come back to me for a follow-up telling me, "I tried the diet, but it's difficult. I can't stick to it." I noticed that my American patients didn't have the devotion to food that was found in the Italian culture I grew up in. When I told them the diet included all-you-can-eat fish and chicken entrees, they thought fish had to mean salmon or tuna, when there are so many kinds of fish out there. They also didn't know how to cook it, nor did they have healthy, flavorful recipes for chicken. So I took the time to help them lose weight by writing recipes down on my prescription pad to get them started. I would say, "Look, it's not hard. You just have to be creative. Here, try these." And I'd scribble a couple of fish or chicken recipes down for them, based on my and my mother's Sicilian recipes. And miraculously, my patients started losing weight. They couldn't believe the easy and delicious meals they could eat while they were losing weight. Initially, I would prescribe the diet to patients who had illnesses that had clear connections to being overweight, such as hypertension, type 2 diabetes, as opposed to type 1, which you're born with, and sleep apnea. As my medical practice continued, however, it became apparent how much being overweight set the stage for untold numbers of illnesses and diseases, and how important it was to lose weight as preventive medicine. My patient profile is no different from the patient population of doctors' offices around the country. My new patients are coming in increasingly heavier, and the illnesses related to being overweight and obese are becoming much more frequent. The weight of Americans has been rising at an astonishing rate since the early 1960s, due to a combination of diet, meal size, activity habits, genetics, and food industry and media influence. As most people know by now, either by reading statistics or by just glancing around themselves at a crowded location, around 2/3 of our citizens are either overweight or obese. And there appears to be every indication that this trend will continue. Not coincidentally, the United States is in the midst of major epidemics of heart disease, stroke, high blood pressure, cancer, type 2 diabetes, and hepatitis. These conditions are all clearly exacerbated, if not caused, by excess weight, and are major causes of disability and death in this nation. They also account for a significant amount of our healthcare dollars. The shocking statistics. Approximately 2 out of 3 Americans are either overweight or obese, compared with fewer than 1 out of 4 in the early 1960s. Around 127 million American adults are overweight, with 44 to 60 million of them obese, and 9 million severely obese. Approximately 15% of children ages 6 to 19 are overweight or obese. This prevalence has nearly tripled in the past 3 decades. Obesity may shorten lifespan by 5 to 20 years. Obesity is currently associated with greater disease and poorer health-related quality of life than smoking, problem drinking, and poverty. The World Bank has estimated the cost of obesity in the United States at 12% of the national healthcare budget, according to the World Watch Institute. The leading causes of death in the United States are all exacerbated or caused by excess weight. Heart disease is the leading cause of death in the United States. Cancer is the second leading cause. Stroke is the third leading cause. Type 2 diabetes, 95% of diabetics, is currently the 6th ranking cause of death, and it recently became the 4th leading cause of death in New York City. Type 2 diabetes also increases the risk of heart attack and stroke by 2 to 4 times and is the leading cause of blindness, fatal kidney disease, and lower extremity amputations. In addition to helping people look better and feel better, which I am all for, it's terribly important to reverse this trend of health problems in our country. People may be living longer due to advances in medication and healthcare management, but many diseases can be greatly improved or completely prevented without the use of drugs or surgical intervention. Take insulin resistance. Highly related to being overweight, it is a condition in which your body fails to respond properly to insulin. Around 1/4 of Americans have it, unbeknownst to them, and it puts them at significant risk for developing full-blown diabetes. The first line of defense for this condition is, you guessed it, losing weight. Even a small percentage of weight loss can help appreciably. So, I am sure you want to know, how do you get there? Let me tell you a little bit about the healthiest known diet in the world. In the 1950s, the role of diet in human health was a mystery. Most researchers accepted that there was a connection between diet and disease, but the nature of this connection was largely unstudied in human populations. In 1958, a young physician named Ansel Keys of the University of Minnesota, along with a team of international scientists, set out to understand one disease in particular, the disease that was killing more people around the world than any other, heart disease. Animal studies had suggested that fats were to blame for heart disease, but there was only anecdotal evidence for humans. During World War II, for example, Keys had observed that heart disease rates plummeted in countries with shortages of meat and dairy products, both rich in saturated fats. In addition, when he and his wife had traveled around Europe and Africa measuring blood cholesterol levels in preliminary studies in the early 1950s, he noticed that affluent people who were eating more meat and dairy products had higher cholesterol and suffered more heart attacks than poorer people who could only afford limited amounts of those foods. Keys thus speculated that saturated fat might be the root of the problem and was responsible for increasing the risk of heart disease. To test his hypothesis, Keys and his co-investigators looked at the diets, lifestyles, blood pressures, and blood cholesterol levels of more than 12,000 healthy middle-aged men from Greece, Italy, Japan, Finland, the Netherlands, Yugoslavia, and the United States. For the first time, investigators were actually stationed in people's homes to monitor what they were eating and sending samples back to their own laboratory for analysis, rather than relying on food intake questionnaires. They then followed up after 5, 10, 15, and 20 years. It came to be known as the Seven Countries Study, one of the greatest and most influential epidemiological studies of our time. 10 years after the study began, men from East Finland were faring the worst. 28% of them had developed heart disease. It turns out the Finns were eating more saturated fat than almost anyone in the world, 24% of their calories. That's double what Americans eat now. The residents of the fishing villages that were studied in Japan ate the least fat overall, and the least saturated fat. Only 5% of them developed heart disease, far better than the Finns. But it wasn't the best. That honor went to the men from the Greek island of Crete. After 10 years, only 2% of them had developed heart disease, and none of them had died. Amazingly, the Cretans were eating about as much total fat as the artery-clogged Finns. 30 to 40% of their total daily calories came from fat. The difference was that their intake of saturated fat was far lower. It was not, however, as low as that of the mostly rice and vegetables Japanese diet. When the blood cholesterol of the Cretans was measured, they had the lowest levels of any group. This was a conundrum, because the investigators had been assuming that saturated fat from the diet played a principal role in one's blood cholesterol level. How could the Cretans, who ate more saturated fat than the Japanese, be healthier than the Japanese, who ate hardly any saturated fat? This mystery was answered when it was learned that the kinds of unsaturated fats they were eating were also making a difference. The Cretans were getting nearly half of their fat from olive oil, a monounsaturated fat, and it created the best lipid profile for a human body that you could ask for. Keyes thus established one of the most important pieces of knowledge we can arm ourselves with for good health. By monitoring the kinds of fat we eat, more so than the amount, we can minimize or prevent heart disease, the number one worldwide killer. The Seven Countries Study also determined that rates of death from all causes, age for age, were among the lowest in the Mediterranean regions. The Seven Countries Study was essentially the launch for many studies to follow over the next several decades to try to elucidate what makes the Mediterranean diet so healthy, in addition to dramatically reducing heart disease. Currently, it appears that concentrating on fresh, unprocessed food that was largely plant-based, along with some fish, olive oil, dairy, wine, and a little red meat, gave people of the Mediterranean the magic formula. Their diet had the best combination of fats, was high in complex carbohydrates and fiber, and was also rich in a combination of antioxidants, phytochemicals, vitamins, and minerals, the total effect of which cannot be duplicated with pills or supplements. These investigations have also taught us that, in addition to heart disease, the Mediterranean diet can help prevent obesity, heart attacks, cancer, arthritis, type 2 diabetes, hypertension, and the metabolic syndrome, among others. In reading about Keyes' studies, I learned that his first destination, back in 1952, was the southern Italian town of Naples. He was drawn there because of the reports he'd heard that heart disease barely existed among Neapolitans. As it turned out, area doctors confirmed that their hospitals rarely had coronary patients. The only cases were seen at private clinics for the well-to-do. The men of the working class, who couldn't afford the meats and dairy the upper classes could, had remarkably low cholesterol and almost no heart trouble. But the thing that struck me most about his experience was when he described the simple yet irresistible cuisine of the region. The ordinary food of the common Neapolitans consisted of homemade minestrone or vegetable soup, pasta in endless variety, always freshly cooked, served with tomato sauce and a sprinkle of cheese, only occasionally enriched with some bits of meat, or served with a little local seafood without any cheese. A hearty dish of beans and macaroni. Lots of whole grain bread, never more than a few hours from the oven, and never served with any kind of spread. Great quantities of fresh vegetables. A modest portion of meat or fish, perhaps twice a week. Red wine. Always fresh fruit for dessert. When Keyes was asked, years later, to formulate a diet that might serve as a preventive against coronary heart disease, he could come up with nothing more suited for this purpose than the traditional working-class diet of early 1950s Naples. I realized with astonishment that he was talking about the diet I grew up on. Sicily, an island off the southern coast of Italy, and a place of dramatic beauty, history, and dazzlingly fresh and healthy cuisine, is the largest island in the Mediterranean. It's also the island I lived on until the age of 9, when my family moved to America. I lived in a small hilly town near the Mediterranean Sea called Castrofilippo. To me, it's the most beautiful place on earth, rugged, rocky, and colorful, with weather the most optimal in the world. Springtime occurs in February, and then there's virtually no rain from May to September. We had an abundance of different varieties of fruits and vegetables because of this climate. In fact, there were very few, if any, grocery stores where you'd buy vegetables, because everyone grew their own. What's more, it was actually a necessity to eat a diet rich in vegetables, legumes, fruits, homemade whole grain breads and pasta, and olive oil made from the olives of our own trees. Even our wine was made from our own grapevines. Because most people were poor and couldn't afford to buy much, meat in particular. Meat was considered to be a luxury. However, because of our proximity to the ocean, we always had fresh fish available to us. Perhaps partly because of our limited access to a vast selection of foods, such as the options Americans have at their disposal today, we made the most of what we had and paid a lot of attention to food preparation, flavor, and meal times. It should be noted, however, that though the culture I grew up in ate the traditional Mediterranean diet, it's not the case today. As my town, as well as the rest of the Mediterranean, became more affluent over the years, the diet of its inhabitants slowly became more westernized, with more meats, dairy, and other sources of saturated fat entering into the diet, as well as refined grains. So even though the Mediterranean has historically been a healthy and lean region, it is not so anymore. Many more people there are carrying excess weight from their more Americanized diets, and American weight-related health problems have followed. Because of the great benefits of the Mediterranean diet, I decided to adapt my weight loss diet so that it could ease people into this exceptionally healthy way of eating. My goal was to take people from a rapid weight loss phase with Mediterranean-style recipes into a maintenance plan in which they will be fully eating Mediterranean. I designed it so that in the first 2 weeks, you should lose 5 to 10 pounds if you follow the diet plan closely. For those who wish to lose more than that, they can continue on the 2-week weight loss stage. When you are ready, you can transition to the maintenance stage. I knew the plan had to be practical, livable, effortless, and most of all, delicious, or no one would adopt it into their lives. Once I had the foundation, I took it upon myself to select the perfect recipes for the plan. While I come from a family with a long tradition of cooking, I never cooked until I went to medical school. It began as a matter of necessity. The deal I had with my roommates was that I would cook and they would wash the dishes. They soon caught on that I was getting my mother to make the meatballs and sauce. I would heat up some pasta, throw the pre-made meatballs and sauce over the pasta, and then go into my bedroom to relax. My roommates were faintly annoyed, but they couldn't resist the meals, so they let me continue for the whole first year of school. As time wore on, though, in the second and third years of medical school, I'd call my mother to get advice on how she made this or that. I began to keep her on the phone with me the whole time I was cooking. It was fun for me to cook and for us to bond in this way. And my roommates continued to do all the cleaning. At this point, they were so supportive of the deal that they started coming home early so we could all eat together. Eventually, I began cooking for family and countless friends as well. And it became a big part of my life. I love making and creating delicious dishes and then sharing them. Trying my recipes definitely seems to be my patients' favorite part of my diet. It makes me feel great that they enjoy them so much and that they are taking pleasure in something I provided. In fact, it's no surprise that the Mediterranean diet has demonstrated over and over in studies that, because of its palatability, people are able to stick with it, much more so than other diets. You can eat chicken cacciatore, grilled shrimp with thyme, sweet and sour red snapper, striped bass oregano, lentil soup, and pasta with peas, asparagus, and tomato sauce. Now, that doesn't sound like deprivation, does it? I want to emphasize that it's not just about the food, however. Part of the wonderful, beneficial health effects from living in the Mediterranean just may be due to the lifestyle as well. During the post-war era, when the studies were done, Mediterraneans were physically active, had a slower pace of living, relied on and communed with family and friends, and, probably as a result of all of this, had less stress. They had great reverence for the food on their table. I greatly encourage you to follow their course. Take the time to eat. Take the time to do what's important in life, which is to make good food and share it with friends and family. These meals are highly nutritious for the whole family, anyone over the age of 2. So prepare them to share. I truly believe this is one of the problems our country faces. We have de-emphasized dinner time with our families and the importance of food in our daily lives. Mealtime should be a time to enjoy, gather, savor, and linger. Food should be a pleasure, not a forbidden, dreaded part of life, ridden with anxiety and guilt. I have created delicious, easy-to-follow recipes as a starting point. My goal in helping you make a lasting change in weight and health was to make a plan that was desirable, pleasurable, simple, and maintainable. And I think I have done that. It cannot be a regimented, day-by-day rule book. It must be infinitely variable and flexible, able to adjust to a person's cravings and degree of hunger, the contents of the refrigerator, or the offerings at whatever restaurant he or she winds up at. Moreover, in place of food that is mouth-watering and high in calories, there must be something healthy but equally mouth-watering and easy to attain. And that is what this book provides. You can change your life if you follow my plan. You need to be at your best weight to be your best self, and I want to help you get there. In essence, when you become fit, you become able to free your mind from worrying about weight control, and instead can concentrate on the things that matter most to you in life. First and foremost, you need to get rid of the idea of keeping it off. I think most people who feel they have excess pounds feel overweight. That is, like a normal-sized person who is over his or her natural weight. Keeping it off implies you are a fat person struggling to maintain an unnaturally thin state. Instead, I will show you how to find your comfortable weight and stay there. Once you've reached your new set point, the reduction of your cravings and your new mindset will make you feel as if you belong there. Not that you're fighting anything. The struggle is over. This book is not just a quick fix for the high school reunion. It's a prescription for life. Success Stories. Ted lost 95 pounds over 8 months. I had gained quite a bit of weight after a debilitating injury that caused me to be extremely sedentary for quite a while. Dr. Acquista put me on his diet and wrote out a bunch of recipes for me on his prescription pad. It's the best diet I've ever been on, bar none. I thought the recipes were very tasty and very satisfying. I think that was a big key for me. It really helped me to have a dinner where I could eat as much as I wanted because it made me feel a little like I was cheating. It wasn't about portion control, such an awful part of other diets. This doesn't feel like a diet. It feels like I've been to a restaurant and had a wonderful gourmet meal. The first few weeks I struggled a little with cravings, but it was okay since I was just starting out and was highly motivated, so I could ignore them. I added a few things back in, like some fruit, whole grain bread, 2% milk, low-fat yogurt, sugar-free sorbet, and some pasta. Personally, I try to keep the olive oil down somewhat because of all the calories. Anyway, working out really helped with the cravings, because it made me feel like I'm putting so much into this, I'm not going to ruin it by going out and eating double hamburgers and ice cream. The cravings really stopped once I started exercising. What I find most amazing was the relatively short duration required for a dramatic weight loss. Other plans would say it would take a couple of years of being disciplined, and I didn't feel I could wait that long. Once the weight comes off, you can eat a much more varied diet and can exercise less to maintain your weight. My health also improved on the diet. I'd been suffering from sleep apnea, which improved greatly, while fatigue, elevated liver test results, and high blood pressure totally disappeared. Marty lost 15 pounds on the 2-week weight loss stage. I have been trying to lose weight for a couple of years. I lost weight before, but had to do it without eating things I liked. So after I went off the diet, I inevitably gained the weight back. I loved this diet because I could eat foods I like and I still lost weight. Also, I didn't eat any red meat for 2 weeks and my digestion got so much better. I have much more energy now and also think that my skin looks better. Rob lost 10 pounds on the 2-week weight loss stage. My wife and I really enjoyed cooking and eating the dinner options together. As opposed to previous diets I've done, which made me feel deprived, I felt like the Mediterranean prescription left me feeling sated. I was especially impressed with the results, given that a recent knee injury had curtailed my physical activity. Thanks, Dr. Acquista. Charles lost 46 pounds over 8 months. I didn't do the rapid weight loss program, but went straight to the maintenance stage because I wanted more variety in my daily meals than what the diet plan offered. My meals were often fish, pasta in moderation, and 2 vegetables, maybe 5 times a week. I had red meat about once a week. I ate a lot of fruits and nuts. The weight started coming off, and it did not feel like dieting whatsoever. I always felt full. Prior to the weight loss, I had daily fatigue and was falling asleep at the wheel of my car. I also had high blood pressure. These conditions have both resolved. My blood pressure is back to normal, so my blood pressure medication has been reduced to half. If it stays this way for another month, I'll come off the medication completely. Cherie lost 6 pounds on the 2-week weight loss stage. This is the most effective diet I've ever tried. Since I am not technically overweight, 6 pounds in 2 weeks, and I went off the diet twice, is a wonderful result for me. The meals were easy to prepare, and since it included all types of seafood, there was a lot of variety. I particularly enjoyed using olive oil and balsamic vinegar. I enjoyed the experience and will incorporate many of the meals into my regular diet. It's nice to know that if extra pounds creep on, I can go back to the 2-week stage and quickly get them off. Jerry lost 19 pounds over 7 weeks. I lost 19 pounds without really trying. The diet was just very easy to stick to. The recipes were phenomenal, so I never got bored, which was a very nice part of Dr. Acquista's plan. There was no plain boiled chicken and things like that. There was something new every night. I ate out a lot as well, but just stuck to the plan at restaurants. I wasn't exercising and cheated a little with the occasional cocktail, but the weight came right off. I keep telling all my friends that they have to try this diet. I'm that excited about it. The plan. A weight loss diet is not going to change your life. This may sound surprising coming from a doctor who is going to teach you how to lose weight, but I agree with the results of all of the largest studies on diets that have been done. Most diets don't work for long-term weight loss. Even commercial weight loss programs have abysmal results. One of the few that have given themselves over to a published controlled scientific study is Weight Watchers, and it reported only a 3% sustainable weight loss. That's like a 200-pound person losing 6 pounds. This amount of weight loss can have health benefits for some, depending on your body mass index, BMI. But it is probably far short of most people's goals. You probably know from your own experience that most diets don't work. Many people gain the weight right back, and often extra pounds on top of that. In order to permanently change your weight, you must master three principles. Reduce your body fat, which will in turn reduce your appetite. Increase your physical activity. Change your eating habits. There are a million claims out there, but in the scientific literature, these are three proven elements that will give you the ammunition to end your battle to maintain a healthy weight. It's not about timing, special food combinations, restricting food groups, or grapefruit. Brilliant scientists are in their labs around the world at this very moment studying weight loss. There is big money in it, after all, and they have yet to come to any universal agreement about what works except the basic principles just listed. The first one is not as obvious as it may seem. As your body fat increases, so does your appetite. Fat cells aren't just receptacles. They're like little living, breathing survival machines. They send out signals to get you to eat more so they don't perish. They don't know how many other fat cells there are around them that will get you through the next famine. And they don't care that you'd prefer to wear a bikini this upcoming summer. While your appetite can increase initially when losing weight, losing fat will help you control your appetite once you settle into your new set point. After a while post-weight loss, your shrunken fat cells will become less metabolically active, thus slowing down the signaling to your brain. Many of my patients will tell me that before they lost weight, they felt like food controlled them instead of the other way around. A box of cookies in the house meant a box of cookies eaten, possibly in one sitting. Once you get down below a certain threshold, however, your body fat is not screaming at you to save it anymore. Food doesn't control you. Hunger is like a minor headache you can ignore if you want to. You could even keep a cupboard stocked with sweets, and they wouldn't be any more tempting to you than a head of broccoli. So you need a plan that is sustainable, that allows you to eat the foods you love. We're talking about a prescription for life here, that allows you to feel full, and that reduces fat tissue. Increasing your physical activity will help ensure weight loss. High-speed weight loss programs can get you to lose weight, but the early reduction in pounds comes primarily from losing water weight or muscle tissue, not weight from fat tissue. The initial weight loss from low-carbohydrate diets is water weight. By eating fewer carbohydrates, your body burns its stored carbohydrates in the form of glycogen for energy. When your body burns glycogen, water is released, so you lose weight. If you're losing weight too fast, you'll also be burning valuable metabolic rate-increasing muscle tissue. What you want to be doing, of course, is burning fat. Exercise compensates for this phenomenon by increasing muscle and burning fat. A multitude of studies shows that regular exercise also prevents weight regain. People on diets are often looking for the quick fix and see a diet as a solution to a short-term problem. On the contrary, after weight loss, if you want to maintain a healthy weight, you need to adopt lifelong healthy habits. I have a friend who was on a diet and the whole time kept commenting that she couldn't wait to finish it so she could start eating Doritos again. Of course, she went right back to her former weight when she stopped the diet. But who wants to be on a diet for the rest of his or her life? My plan is to teach you healthy eating habits without sacrificing feeling utterly satisfied. To achieve the three goals I have outlined, I have devised a comprehensive plan with two basic stages, the 2-week weight loss stage and the maintenance stage. The 2-week weight loss stage is designed to help you lose weight immediately, kick some bad eating habits, reduce your appetite, and maybe get you into your skinny jeans if you don't have that much to lose. If you haven't reached your target weight in 2 weeks, you may continue on this phase in order to drop pounds. True, the first program is technically a diet, but this is only the beginning. The maintenance stage is the most important part of the Mediterranean prescription, because this is the part that's going to change your eating habits, change your life, and probably give you a few extra years. While other diet books focus on weight loss, this book also features what comes after. The maintenance stage is based on the Mediterranean diet, which allows you to effortlessly maintain your weight, preventing weight regain after the diet, and preventing the gradual creep upward on the scale that most people experience as they age, while helping your heart and helping prevent cancer and other chronic diseases. Since I'm from Sicily, my recipes have an Italian bent, but you can follow the principles of this book eating cuisine from any part of the Mediterranean region, such as Greece, Turkey, France, Spain, the Middle East, and North Africa. Some of my patients skip the 2-week plan entirely and go directly to this stage, and by just changing their eating habits, lose weight. If you choose to begin with the 2-week weight loss stage, I highly recommend that you be strict on it. It is the most difficult leg of my plan, and it will help you disrupt unhealthy eating practices, such as a dependence on unhealthy fats and poor snacking habits. Move on to the maintenance stage when you are ready. In the event that you really get off track and want to lose some quick pounds to get back down, simply follow the 2-week weight loss stage again. Finally, even if you don't want or need to lose any weight, incorporating some of the principles of the Mediterranean prescription into your diet will make you a healthier person than you were before. 12 Guiding Principles. The thing I can't stress enough to my patients is how simple the Mediterranean prescription really is. It's composed of 12 guiding principles, just 12 elements that, when taken together, can help prevent obesity, heart disease, and cancer, and add years to your life, as study after study has shown. Not to mention that it's rich in fiber, protein, and micronutrients that help satiate and suppress your appetite, so you never feel hungry. It allows for decadent meals. See the recipe section, so you never feel deprived. I've included information in the text on how each component helps keep you healthy, and how it can contribute both to weight loss and to easily maintaining your weight once it's off. While maintenance stage eating is not designed for losing weight, some people, depending on their individual combination of weight, body type, age, gender, and level of physical activity, will lose weight if they use the Mediterranean prescription's principles to change their unhealthy eating habits. The 12 Guiding Principles of the Mediterranean Prescription. 1. Eat lots of fruits. 2. Eat lots of vegetables. 3. Eat lots of legumes, such as beans, peas, and lentils. 4. Eat lots of nuts and seeds. 5. Eat lots of whole grains, especially whole grain bread. 6. Use olive oil liberally, both in salads and in cooking. 7. Consume a moderate amount of low-fat dairy products. 8. Eat fish. 9. Eat the right fats. Have a high ratio of unsaturated fats to saturated fats in your diet. 10. Engage in regular physical activity. 11. Drink wine, especially red, in moderation, if you choose. 12. Eat only small amounts of red meat and meat products. The Mediterranean Prescription Pyramid. The pyramid, which can be found in your PDF companion, summarizes the daily, weekly, and monthly recommendations of the Mediterranean prescription. Herein lies the heart of the plan. If you simply followed the proportions in this pyramid, you would be in fine shape and on your way to a healthier, fitter future. The recommendations in the pyramid are for the maintenance stage. If you would like to lose weight, however, refer to Chapter 2 for guidance. 1. Eat lots of fruits. As a small child growing up in Sicily, I never had candy, cake, or ice cream for dessert. We fed our sweet tooths with natural treats. At the end of a meal, my mother would put out a large bowl of fruit and a bowl of nuts, and my father would crack the nuts, cut the fruit, and pass them around. Candy so easily brings a smile to children's faces that it's hard to deprive them of this simple joy. However, it would be vastly better to start them on the fresh fruit habit. Since what children eat is largely a matter of what's available, once they're used to fruit as a snack and dessert, they'll be just as happy with an orange as with the sugar and saturated fat of a candy bar. The same is true for grown-ups. To me, nothing could be a better dessert than a delicious ripe piece of in-season fruit, and I keep them well stocked at home and in my office. My habits have stayed with me since my childhood, and it's never too late to start. A magnificent array of fruits grows in the Mediterranean region, and are eaten as a sumptuous snack or sweet tooth-satisfying dessert at the end of a meal. Fruits are full of essential vitamins and minerals, and most are high in vitamin C, a powerful antioxidant. Many also contain high amounts of carotenoids and other phytochemicals, health-promoting components that likely lend fruits their cancer-preventing qualities. Many studies have linked high fruit consumption, particularly in combination with high vegetable consumption, but also on their own, with lower cancer rates, especially of the digestive and respiratory tracts. While it may be that the protection against cancer weakens the farther from the digestive tract you get, significant protection is still seen for cancers of the liver, pancreas, prostate, breast, and urinary tract. Fruits also help prevent cardiovascular disease. Some studies suggest they may be even more effective than vegetables.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.